Question society stands that the survivor is somehow responsible for instigating sexual violence to herself, and somehow shows incidences of sexual violence that can happen to anyone regardless of how they are dressed. Alright, so our exhibition, as you can see from later on, are actual items of clothing worn by survivors of gender-based violence during the incident, as well as regular clothing worn by the survivors on a daily basis. So,
to be here today, and also good afternoon to everyone, ladies and gentlemen, members of the media. I can't believe it that I'm able to be here today to launch the Singapore leg of my Don't Tell Me How to Dress exhibition. It's actually been exactly 1 year and 1 week since I picked up a phone and posted, I guess you could call it a rant, on my social media in response to a newspaper headline that caught my attention one morning back in March of 2018, which said, "Don't dress sexy, department tells women." I came across it and something about it just didn't sit right with me. It was right before Songkran holidays, just around this time, and those of you who know Songkran Festival is the Thai New Year. In Thailand, we celebrate by having massive water fights all over the country, in addition to asking for merit and giving blessings. It's a lot of fun. But amidst the fun and festivities, there's also a sharp rise in crime, including sexual assault and harassment crimes. In fact, over 60% of Thai women have reported being harassed or assaulted at some point during Songkran. So you can imagine, after I saw this headline and I started to read the entire article, and there was absolutely no mention of any other safety precautionary measures, any other stern warning to people thinking of harassing or assaulting anyone, regardless of gender. Nope, there was nothing of the sort, except how this year the local authorities were launching a campaign telling women how to dress. By the time I got to the end of the article, I was hot with anger. And that's why I picked up my phone and recorded what I just thought was just gonna be me venting my frustration and didn't think much of it. You see, I was one of those 60% of women who have been assaulted during Songkran. It happened to me not by one, but by five men. In the middle of the day, in the middle of a fun, fantastic Songkran party, it happened to me even though I was wearing a baggy black t-shirt and three-quarter length jean shorts. It happened to me when I was 17 years old, and to this day I've never gone and took part in any Songkran festivities. Little did I know at the time that 1 minute online rant of mine would turn into a proper social movement in my country and now potentially around the region. Overnight, it had gone viral with hundreds and then thousands of women chiming in and sharing their stories, sharing their frustrations and anger at the fact that women are ones constantly being blamed when it comes to cases of sexual assault and harassment, and how easy it is that society points a finger at how a woman was behaving, what she was doing, or how she was dressed, instead of focusing on the perpetrators and holding them accountable for their actions. You see, there are still so many widespread myths and misconceptions when it comes to this issue of sexual assault and indeed gender-based violence. Many people think that rape occurs in a public place or outside of the home by a complete stranger, when in fact, based on the UN trial of rape, UN Women report called Trial of Rape, 91% of women report knowing their perpetrators, and it is happening in our communities, it is happening in our families, and it is happening in our homes. There's this idea that rape is only a crime or even a problem if it happens to a good or an innocent girl. And if a woman was deemed to be dressing or behaving inappropriately, well, it's to be expected, or in some cases even justified. There's this belief that assault must result in visible injury if an incident truly happened without consent, while in many cases there is no physical trauma, which then poses a challenge when that woman tries to report the incident or collect evidence. Too often women do not seek help because they are afraid to speak out. When they do speak out, they feel ashamed and blamed for the violence committed against them by the very people tasked with protecting them. I realized that this was a conversation long overdue, so then I created the hashtag #DontTellMeHowToDress and invited my celebrity friends in Thailand to post on social media and push back against what I feel is an infringement on our basic human rights. And within a few days, we were able to create the level of visibility needed to create a proper social movement, and it started to catch the attention of international news media, and some of them even likened Don't Tell Me How to Dress to that of the Me Too movement in the West. So then I was like, oh, now what am I gonna do? I realized I had a lot of people listening to what I had to say, so I wanted to go further. I teamed up with the Thai government, with UN Women in Thailand, with local NGOs, and other partners, including Canadian Embassy, in order to create the Social Power Exhibition Against Sexual Assault. In it, we displayed actual clothing worn by victims at the time of their assault, in order to really highlight and question, is it really what a woman wears? And the outfits themselves speak for themselves. We had university student outfits. We had play clothes of a two-year-old toddler. We had work clothes of a woman just going to work on a daily basis. We also featured photographs of celebrities and influencers with the hopes that with their visibility and their powerful voices, they're able to shed a light on an issue that is most often kept in the dark, hidden away, and not spoken of.
You are absolutely right. The right to live free from violence is a basic human right. Not specific to gender, it's a basic human right. But gender-based violence continues to exist around the world, affecting women, girls, irrespective of age, location, situation, or background. Over the years, there has been progress, but so little. The numbers remain shocking. The stories, heart-wrenching. It's said that gender-based violence is a global pandemic. If you think about it, 1 in 3 women worldwide has experienced
this as a survivor. And meeting other survivors, I have observed that there's so much more education needed. Here in Singapore, not just in how we relate to survivors, but overall, how we relate to one another on a day-to-day basis. I just want to note here that for myself and for many of the survivors I've met, the term victim is not one we identify with, purely because the word victim connotates victimhood. And when we change the way we address ourselves and speak to ourselves as survivors, that actually marks the road, the turning point towards our empowerment. In 2010, I authored an article, Does My Short Skirt Invite You to Violate Me? This can be found on Aware's website. It details an incident I had with a group of men who spoke about another woman saying that her attire was asking for it. I showed no outward signs, but deep down, I was very, very triggered, hurt, and upset. Because by then, I had already experienced multiple incidents of sexual violence here in Singapore.
And then we don't end there. We ask many other questions. Why didn't you fight? Why didn't you scream? Why didn't you do this? What were you doing at that point of time, right? And then we keep shifting responsibility from the perpetrator to the survivor. And by the end of the day, before you know it, we have a victim-blaming society where we keep asking these questions, right? So what happens is what's wrong with making a victim-blaming society, like Pam shared and all of them shared, right? We end up pushing survivors to a corner where they don't want to then speak to somebody. And then we go full circle and then come back to the survivors and say, why didn't you report before? Why didn't you tell anybody before, right? And that's like amazing to another level, where we are the ones, knowingly or unknowingly, right, from the best of our intentions, ask these questions, because we are victim of the same social fabric, but in the end, keep blaming the survivor for not doing this or not doing that, right? Let's start and shift responsibility to the people who are making those choices to assault someone, right? I always say this, when somebody is wearing a certain type of clothing and we all have questions about it, there are hundreds of people in the room who do not choose to violate this person. But there's always this one person who makes that excuse, look at what she was wearing, and so it was okay. And we fall for those myths, right? So let's not do that. And I'm so grateful for the panel here, for Cindy, for doing such an amazing work. AWARE runs a sexual assault care center where day in and day out, we try and tell every survivor, it's not your fault, right? You may ask, so what do I ask? What do I say to survivors? 4 golden sentences for everybody, a short training over here. It's not your fault. It's your choice what you want to do. You want to report, you don't want to report, it's fine. It's your experience. My experience is not worse than yours. And I'm here to support you, right? So you can say these 4 sentences. And before you know it, we change a victim-blaming society to a culture of support such that when #MeToo happens, there is not a single comment online that says, what were you wearing, right? So AWARE Sexual Assault Care Center last year saw 800 survivors, and this year we're expecting more than 1,000 survivors. And these are survivors who experience non-physical forms to physical forms of sexual assault. And we have very, very, very brave women who've come forward today and have actually given their clothes to show to you that this doesn't invite sexual assault, right? So in respect to their courage, I urge each one of you to please walk around these installations, right? The first thing that comes to your mind, please write it on your phone, copy it to your social media platforms, and hashtag DTMHDD, as well as hashtag AimForZero campaign. What is AimForZero? AimForZero is an initiative by AWARE for the next 2 years, where we are promoting zero tolerance to sexual violence. So you remember, shifting the blame, let's put it back. Let's aim for a zero tolerance society so that whoever walks to us and says, I don't know what she was wearing, she was inviting, then you are the one who's standing there, don't tell her what to wear. And you have these brochures in your packets, aim for zero. So if you want to support this campaign, we need money, we need people giving their time, and we want to support initiatives like this to amplify our voices. So please join us for the next 2 years to do something about this. Thank you very much.